We'll put this into I will put this into a broader context because the Hungary is just an example for a broader process. That is the title of my presentation: Hybrid Regimes and Democratic Backsliding in Europe, and the case of Hungary will be emphasized. This is my name here. I am just mentioning because that's the correct writing of it. And let me move to the broader context. And this is, oops. I try to just move to the. Okay, so I'd like to differentiate between old school dictatorships and sort of new 21st century authoritarian or hybrid regimes. The old school dictatorships these faces demonstrate represent the military oppression or secret services and killing several hundreds and thousands of people, but it doesn't seem to be the case anymore in the 21st century, when there are new forms of non-democratic regimes. You don't have to jail a lot of people or kill a lot of people in order to maintain a non-democratic regime. So this is a bit of a comparison between the 20th century and 21st century dictatorships. I would say modern versus postmodern despotism. And it's important to take a look on this similarities or dif or rather the differences. So in the Cold War period, the old dictators, the old totalitarian regimes needed coherent ideologies like Marxism or fascism, a strong military, terroristic police. The borders were usually closed or controlled very heavily. Usually there was a one-party system, and in some countries, like in Hungary and in Eastern Europe, there were foreign troops in those countries, like Soviet troops, the Red Army. There was a direct use of violence and the control of private life. And basically, there was no opposition at all. And that is the old picture, you know, the classic dictatorships. And here, what about this postmodern condition, postmodern despotism? The new dictators or the new authoritarian leaders, they rather just use or abuse traditional mentalities, identity, the religion. They need a lot of money in order to keep their followers. They also use a permanent propaganda against Islamic migrants, for instance. Think about what is going on now on the border between Belarus and Poland. That is a really dangerous conflict now because a classic authoritarian regime, that is Lukashenko's Belarus, trying to push the refugees to Poland. And Poland is an illiberal regime, also not a liberal democracy. They have a lot of troops at the border trying to prevent these refugees to come to the country. So it is a real serious situation, and both sides are using permanent propaganda. And this is the way how the Russia and Belarus try to weaken the European Union on its eastern borders. Also in this postmodern dictatorships, negative campaign is important. Some people say that there are some fascistic elements here because they are basing their policies on hate and fear. Also, it is important that part of the population are using social media, digital media, and others not, just the old television. So there is a digital divide between the old and the young, between the countryside and the cities between the educated and the uneducated. The opposition is rather fragmented, and there is a fake democratic legitimacy. Results of the elections are manipulated. It is not simply that, you know, there is no free and fair elections, but these are dishonest, unclean, manipulated elections. So that is the new situation we have to realize. And it is not always clear, because the new dictators try to hide their real nature, their real way of using power. So, and the other thing is that in some countries there is a hybrid regime or autocracy, which used to have democracies. So how on earth could this de-democratization or democratic backsliding could happen? So one way is the classic breakdown of democracy by a military takeover. The other one is more like in Latin America. The other one is the revolution from above. You know, when the democratically elected leader tried to introduce dictatorship from inside, you know, referring to external threat or nationalism, you know. And that happens, let's say, that happened in Nazi Germany in the 1930s. The next one is the foreign occupation or foreign assistance. So foreign military occupation, or maybe the assistance of the secret services, foreign secret services, lead to dictatorship, like it happened in Eastern Europe after 1945, after the Second World War. Many of these countries were occupied by the Soviet troops, and that was the context of introducing a dictatorship. Again, the other is that when there is an unstable democracy and a democratically elected leader can preempt the development of full democracy. This is what happened in Belarus in 1993. In the first time, Lukashenko was democratically elected, but then he used his power to eliminate any further democratic elections. The next one, the fifth one, is the crisis management by protectors or technocrats. You know, it is not when domestic political community decides about the country, but there is an external, you know, the IMF or the European Union or World Bank, some other players set up a leader, and the leader is behaving like a protector. So it's a guardian leadership or technocratic leadership. It can happen at the time of deep economic crisis when there is a technocratic government, or a guardian leadership, you know, in Bosnia-Herzegovina, in the Western Balkans. There is no democracy there because there is no single political community. The country is divided between three different ethnic groups, and they do not consider all of them as part of the same common political community. And finally, hollowing out stable democracy from inside. So once there is already, it is not a preemptive step. There is already a relatively stable liberal democracy, but step by step, this is dried up, hollowed out. Leader uses high linkage with the West, with core countries, in order to deconstruct full democracy step by step. This is the Hungarian case, when Viktor Orbán, a democratically elected leader, used the support of the European Union to redirect these tons of money for his own purposes and political direction, for his own party, for his own political allies, and undermining democracy. So what are the symptoms of the emerging gray zone? It is a clear symptom that I already mentioned, that the authoritarian leader comes to power by free election, but disrespects the democratic procedure. So the real danger is not coming from outside. The danger is coming from inside. The new autocrats are using the democratic institutions and the democratic instruments to climb up to power and then to abuse the democratic rules and change them to autocracy. So the danger is coming from inside. The second point, the leader creates a personalist regime, an informal, centralized, vertically operating system of rule, when loyalty is much more important than expertise. Social autonomies like universities, think tanks, NGOs, civil society organizations are considered as dangerous. You have to choose whether you support the regime or you are considered as an enemy. And just because some groups have social autonomy, they are immediately considered as enemies by the state. So the state is occupied from inside. That's important. This is what I mentioned, by a political clique. The leader is using ethnicism, populism, and nationalism, speaks on behalf of the native people, condemns the international elites, condemns foreign migrants, and considers them as enemies. So, although the leader belongs to the domestic elite, still he or she pictures these native peoples as the losers in the international arena, because there is a global elite and the global elite wants to destroy the domestic sovereignty of a country. That is the argument. This is the propaganda. And the foreign global elite like Brussels or Washington, etc., New York City, they are using these Islamic migrants to put pressure on these countries in Southern Europe and Eastern Europe. So these are the migrants are presented as the instruments, the tools of the global elite. On the other hand, the leader does not want to introduce traditional dictatorship. He wants to stay as clean and not using openly violent methods. Maybe there are some secretly violent methods, but not openly violent methods, and regular elections, but the regular elections are manipulated, unfair, unfree. But they need these facades in order to present themselves as Democrats. And the leader can claim that, look, I am a Democrat, I was elected by the people. But that is manipulated, you know, so it is a lie. So regime is much more based on fears and traditional mentalities of the population rather than any ideology. So it is not an ideology-driven system. The leaders don't believe in any ideology. They are just applying certain ideologies according to the political necessity. But there is no consistency here at all. Again, the symptoms of the emerging gray zone, they try to repoliticize the public sphere. This is what they promise, to fight technocracy, reviving political community, but at the end, it is just central propaganda, not politicization, but central propaganda and chaotic public policy. So there is a constant flux, and that is the important part of any dictatorship, that only the leader knows really deeply what is going on. Loyal people don't know what will be the next step. Only one person, or maybe two, three, five persons, know the punchline, the narrative which should be done. So in the lack of any external constraint, the regime might go down on the road to full autocracy. The other important thing is that corruption is not deviant. It is not like, you know, some institutions are corrupt. This is a systemic phenomenon. This is embedded, legislated, and networked phenomenon. It is the government which creates the corruption. Therefore, the Orbán government, by some analysis, is called mafia state. Because the mafia is not separate from the state. It is not attacking the state from outside, but the state is occupied by the mafia. So there is no difference between the mafia and the state. The state is the real mafia, and the corruption is legislated according to the need of this clique. So therefore, when the European Union makes an investigation and sends some people to Budapest and telling the Orbán government that, look, you have to do this and this and this differently, because there are some corrupt phenomena in your country, then it is just ridiculous, because it is the Orbán government which makes it systematically corrupt. So it is not a deviant phenomenon. And this is just the wrong body to address. But the European Union is simply unprepared to, you know, contact other than the governments, because the European Union is composed by the member states. And the European Union is based on the idea that the member states are democratic states and not driven by autocratic corruption. On the other hand, the leaders can learn from each other, not just the democratic leaders, but the autocratic leaders. So there is an autocracy promotion, how to manipulate the elections, how to control the media. Orbán and Kaczynski learned a lot from Erdogan in Turkey or Putin in Russia. So even if there are players outside the European Union, they have an influence inside the European Union. Yet, of course, there are a lot of unanticipated spontaneous actions which can occur. I am not suggesting that everything is following the same blueprint. No, there are a lot of differences. And finally, the final symptoms of the emerging gray zone, like hybrid regimes, competitive authoritarian regimes, electoral authoritarian systems, is when a country is member of the European Union and the European Union is a community of democratic states, then the leader enters a cynical and hypocritical game with the European Union, taking the material benefits from the common basket, but disrespecting the common democratic norms. I think this is a problem. It is a, you know, really cheating the game. And this is what some leaders like Orbán did in the first part of the last decade, in the 2010s. So there is also not, these policies are not simply illiberal or tough, but there is also a redistribution of property among the old and the new elites. There is a renationalization of the private property. The state takes their property and later on they reprivatize for themselves. So renationalization and reprivatization, it's like a pendulum to redistribute it for themselves and to their clients. Okay, this is a table from Levitsky and Wei, from their famous book, The competitive authoritarianism, hybrid regimes after the Cold War, competitive authoritarianism, that's the title, and the subtitle is hybrid regimes after the Cold War, after the Cold War. And they differentiate between three types of regimes: the liberal democracies, hybrid regimes, and authoritarian regimes. There is not much talk about totalitarianism anymore. It's like it is a history, but in reality, if you think about Cuba or North Korea, it can also be totalitarian regimes, but the large majority is authoritarian. So I don't want to read what is written here, but take a look on the hybrid regimes. That is, opposition parties can legally contest the elections. So there are legal opposition parties who are compete, but the elections are dishonest and not clean. Elections are just one route to power, not the only route to power. And incumbents exploit the state and violate at least one of the following elements of democracy: free and fair elections, civil liberties, and even level playing field. Level or even playing field, which means that all political parties have equal access to the media and the law. And I think the Orbán regime makes huge mistakes or hurts hugely in all the three elements: free and fair elections, civil liberties, and level playing field. So there is an uneven playing field in Hungary. Opposition activities are legal, but disadvantaged. And it is possible that the incumbents lose elections, but it is not the regular case. It is just exceptional case. So in a normal liberal democracy, it is a distinctive feature that governments lose elections. If governments do not lose elections, then you can be suspicious that it is not a real democracy. It is possible that a democratic government stay in power for 15 years or more, like in Germany, Angela Merkel, you know, but it was clear that all elections in Germany were free. In some other countries, when the incumbents are staying, like in Putin's Russia or Lukashenko's Belarus, or more recently Erdogan's Turkey, there is a problem with democracy, to say at least. So this is Levitsky and Wei. Now you can read it in larger picture. These are civilian regimes, not military regimes. They are widely viewed as the primary means of gaining power, to formal democratic institutions, elections. Elections are used to come to power, but the incumbents abuse the state, so there is a significant advantage vis-a-vis their opponents. And such regimes are competitive because the opposition parties take it really seriously, but they are not democratic because of the playing field is heavily skewed in favor of the incumbents. So as they formulate, competition is real, but unfair. Unfair, and I would also say unfree the election. But hybrid regimes are not totally new in Europe. If you look back to the 1990s, we can have some examples for it. So when certain post-communist regimes were, you know, getting rid of the communist character and the authoritarian character, but still not democratic, not liberal democratic, and that was the case in Romania under Iliescu, in Slovakia under Vladimir Mečar, in Croatia under Tuđman, a newborn state, you know, driven by nationalism, and Yugoslavia under Milosevic, and the small Yugoslavia, I mean, Vojvodina, Kosovo was still part of Yugoslavia, and Montenegro was also part of Yugoslavia, and Serbia, of course, and that was led by Slobodan Milosevic until 2000, and he was then sent to The Hague in the Netherlands to International Tribunal. He was not convicted because he died before of the decision. And I would say Bosnia-Herzegovina, which is a protectorate since 95. And Ukraine, I think Ukraine is also not a full autocracy. There are competing groups for power. But the rules of the game are infected by authoritarian tendencies, and the Orange Revolution was a major push towards democracy. But after, you know, when Yanukovych came to power, and then Poroshenko, there were again and again the establishment of a electoral authoritarian or competitive authoritarian system, which is some sort of softer form of authoritarianism. Albania sometimes tends to be a little bit more democratic, but basically in the last 30 years it was a hybrid regime. And Macedonia, today it is called North Macedonia, is again a hybrid regime. Since 2016, there was a wave of democratization, but here the European Union sort of did not give the Macedonians a green light for European Union accession. They did not start the negotiations. So the democratic government is now in a big trouble because they could not deliver the start of the EU negotiations. It is interesting the role of the European Union to the non-member states, but those small states who are located in the semi-periphery or in the European periphery, like Bosnia, Serbia, Montenegro, Kosovo, Albania, North Macedonia, the Western Balkans. In the meantime, Croatia, Romania, Bulgaria are member states, but these smaller countries are not. And the European Union doesn't seem to be willing to pick up these countries as member states because these are very problematic countries and they don't want to give them full voting rights. So what they play is, you know, not to push them towards democracy, not to present them democracy as an attractive choice. In words, yes, they say this, but in reality, they are quite happy as long as these countries in the Western Balkans remain peaceful, there is an order and stability. A sort of stable hybrid regime is accepted. And therefore, Montenegro, Albania, Macedonia was picked up by the NATO in order to prevent the Russian influence, but not by the European Union. The European Union wants to keep this region stable. So some people ironically call this not autocracies, not democracies, but stabilitocracies. Stabilitocracies meaning that only stability and order matters to prevent ethnic conflicts. So a few examples: in the 1990s, Ion Iliescu was a communist leader. He was a supporter for a while Nicolae Ceaușescu, the dictator, the sultanistic totalitarian dictator. But then he was marginalized within the communist leadership. And when the revolution occurred in Romania in December 1989, and it was successful, and Ceaușescu was, you know, deprived from power, then suddenly Iliescu and his people, his supporters, suddenly appeared on the television and saying, look, the revolution is victorious, I am your leader, please follow me. And he immediately banned the Communist Party. He was also a communist, but had banned his own party. And he established the National Salvation Front. And he said, we are setting up the first free elections very quickly. And he was really quick to do that by May 1990. So the opposition, the real democratic opposition, had no time to organize itself. So Iliescu was elected as president of Romania. That is a presidential leaning system. And he stayed in power until 1996. And the previous totalitarian regime was so harsh that people were grateful to him that he created better life conditions for a while. But he lost to a true democratic candidate in 96. So we can say that in Romania, there was a slow transition to democracy, not in 1990, but in 96. The other one is Slovakia, and this guy is Vladimir Mečiar. When he was young, he was wanted to be a boxer. You can see his face. He was boxing more or less professionally, but then he became a leader Public Against Violence, that is one of the opposition parties in Czechoslovakia. And after the separation of Czech Republic and Slovakia, he represented his own party, which was a right-wing party, but he was basically a post-communist autocrat trying to privatize the communist factories to his friends. And it was very difficult for Slovakians because he was a populist and very relatively popular in Slovakia. And in 1998, finally, the European Union had a very positive intervention, and also the NATO. They said, look, there is a crucial election. Here, Slovakia has to decide whether to go to West or to go to East. If you want to vote for Mečiar, then you will reinforce the Russian relationship. If you want to vote for the United Opposition, Dzurinda, led by Dzurinda, then you will have you will be a member of the European Union. So the stake was the Western integration and European Union and NATO membership. So no wonder that the United Opposition could manage to beat Vladimir Mečiar. But that was a concerted effort. It was not easy. It is now an example for Hungary, how 23 years ago the Slovaks could democratize their country and could get rid of a truly disturbing, poisonous autocratic rule. And I have two other examples. One is the small Yugoslavia, you know, after the independence of Croatia, Macedonia, and Slovenia and Bosnia. And that was led by Slobodan Milosevic. He was a lawyer originally, but then a member of the Communist Party. He made a career of the Communist Party, and he came to power as a leading Serbian communist in 1986, when he was playing nationalist slogans against the Albanians. So playing out the nationalist card, Serbs versus Albanians. And that, it was not communist rhetoric, not communist ideology anymore. It was originally a national communist ideology and then more and more nationalist position. He was not a believer. He was cynically playing sometimes the socialist card, sometimes the nationalist card. And when he attacked Kosovo finally, then he provoked an intervention of NATO. And later on, there was a huge protest against him. And he was, and after an election, he was deprived from power. His partner in Croatia was Franjo Tuđman, a former military man from the Yugoslav army. He was not exactly a communist, but member of the Communist Party, but he became a believer nationalist. So while Milosevic was a sort of cynical, Tuđman was a believer. He said that, yes, we want first an illiberal nationalist regime, a majoritarian democracy. He called this majoritarian democracy, but in reality, that was a hybrid regime. And he was ruling the country until he died in 1999. Not very many democratic leaders visited his funeral, but Viktor Orban visited his funeral as early as 1999. So he was the partner of Milosevic in, you know, dividing the former Yugoslavia. He had some plans to create a bigger Croatia, and he not tolerated the opposition. When the mayor of Zagreb was an opposition candidate who got the position, then he claimed that the enemy occupied Zagreb, the capital of Slovakia or Croatia. So, but what about the European Union? What did they say? And I'd like to refer to two documents. One is the Copenhagen Criteria, 1993, in which they said that associate member states, you know, these are the former applicant countries, will become members of the EU if they fulfill the appropriate conditions, political criteria, economic criteria, as and capacity, state capacity, legislative alignment. And the political criteria is the most important, you know, the stable institutions that guarantee democracy, rule of law, human rights, and protection, respect for and protection of minorities. So actually, there was no such thing in the European Union before 1993. This Copenhagen criteria or membership criteria, in other words, that was accepted in 1993 to preparing for the Eastern enlargement. These criteria were not set concerning Greece or Portugal or Spain after dictatorship. They were just taken by the European community. These political and economic criteria were only introduced in the 1990s, a reflection on the need of Eastern countries to join the European Union. And later on, the European Union wanted to accept the constitution. Giscard d'Estaing was responsible for, you know, coordinating these efforts, but it did not go through, because neither the French nor the Dutch supported this. There were referendums in the Netherlands and in France, and they rejected a common European constitution. And instead of the constitution, because there was a need to establish some normative foundations. You know, the European Union already existed without major normative foundations, and the Lisbon Treaty, which replaced the Constitution, the European Constitution, the Lisbon Treaty, Article 2, well, the famous Article 2, laid ground for the basic values, that is respect for human dignity, freedom, democracy, equality, the rule of law, human rights. Also the rights of persons belonging to minorities, ethnic minorities, social minorities, sexual minorities, etc. These values are common to the member states in a society in which pluralism, non-discrimination, tolerance, justice, solidarity, and equality between women and men prevail. So, after all, there is some normative foundations of the European Union quite late. I mean, a lot of countries were already members, like Hungary also already the members of the European Union. And there were some other common values. Those are not so much about politics, but about the economy and social issues, full employment, social progress, high level of protection and improvement of the quality of life, social justice, territorial cohesion and solidarity among the member states. So actually this is the Lisbon Treaty, and there are plenty of references when the European institutions try to negotiate with some deviant member states. And now let me go to Poland and Hungary. These are new autocratic regimes, and Jaroslaw Kaczyński is the Polish leader, but he is not formally a prime minister. He is the president of the leading party, the Party of Law and Justice, a far-right party, very traditionalist, Catholic, nationalists, anti-abortion, and anti-LGBTQ party, but also anti-Russian. So this is a traditional Polish attitude against Germany and against Russia. And the other one, Orbán's Hungary, is more autocratic. Kaczyński's Poland is still a democracy, an illiberal democracy in a way. They do not have a new constitution, do not have two-third qualified majority rules, but Orbán established a new constitution, and this is cannot be so easily eliminated, because that requires two-third majority, not simply absolute majority, and a lot of other fundamental laws which are based on this two-third majority. So what are the characteristics of the Orbán regime in Hungary? And let me remind you that this is exists, I mean, it developed step by step, but this is since 2010. So it is more than 11 years. And next year in the spring, there will be elections, and that will be already 12 years. 12 years, it's like between 1933 and 1945, right? Or between 1945 and 1957. I mean, this is a real era, a real long period. So there is a centralized power. It is more and more like a personalistic regime. And the personalist regime is different from the military regimes and different from the one-party dominated regimes. Military regimes like in Latin America, and one-party dictatorships like the communist regimes, when there were some institutions, you know, when Stalin died, that was a big problem for the communist leadership, but still the regime survived because there was an institution, party, state, secret services, so the regime worked. But in a personalist regime, it can last pretty long as the person is popular. But when the person is eliminated from the picture, maybe he dies or resigns, then the regime can collapse very quickly, because everything is dependent on the person. So it is also a hegemon. There is a hegemonic party, and that is a state party, the Fidesz. But actually, there is not much difference between the party and the state, because the state occupies the party and the party occupies the state. So there is an overlap, a huge overlap between party and the state. And a lot of people who have prominent roles in this regime are not even party members. So just the personal loyals to Viktor Orban. So therefore, it is called sometimes as mafia state. They are populist because they present themselves as the losers against the global elite. But in the meantime, they are elitist. They are using flat text and neoliberal economic policies to exploit the poor people. Poverty is not decreasing in Hungary. It is all in other East European countries. The poverty rate is about 15%. And in Hungary, it is still more than 25%. So they don't aim to make social equality. They are operating with the homogenized concept of the nation. They are ethno-nationalists, ethno-populists, not nationalists in the 19th century sense, but ethnicists, ethnic nationalists. As I mentioned, there is a social exclusion towards the lower classes, and there is a strong wish to change the elites. So they are using anti-communism and anti-liberalism at the same time to attack the former communists and also the liberals. They claim that the two are overlapping groups. There is no rigid ideology, as I said. There is a flexible ruling, and sometimes even there is a state of exception. So we cannot even expect any reliable rules, because since the COVID pandemic, there is an extraordinary situation in Hungary when the parliamentary decisions can be substituted by the government decrees. So it is the classic state of exception, ruling by decrees, meaning nothing can happen against the will of the prime minister Viktor Orban, who is not simply a prime minister, he is a despot of the country. And he always refers to the will of the people. He always refers to so-called revolutionary conditions. There is always a fight against Brussels, against external enemies. So there is a suspension of the rule of law. There is an economic unorthodoxy, nationalism and neoliberalism combined, and culturally patriarchalism and nationalized, politicized Christianity. So it's not like Pope Francis, what Pope Francis represents. It is a nationalization and politicization of Christianity. It is now a partly free country. It is moving quickly toward autocracy, but according to the Freedom House and according to the VDEM index in Göteborg or the Bertelsmann index, this country, Hungary, is not democracy anymore. Since 2014, 2015, these democracy measuring institutions change their mind, and they claim that this is the first hybrid regime in the EU. And actually, that shows that hybridization is not a one-way road from a communist dictatorship to liberal democracy. You know what it happened, like the child disease of democratization. what happened in Slovakia and Romania, but it can be the other way, that you achieve a consolidated liberal democracy, but later on you will go back to a non-democratic regime. And actually the European Union membership has a crucial effect on this. The Kaczyński regime in Poland came to power 5 years later, only in 2015. The leader has no formal function, not a prime minister. There is a governing party close to the far right, again centralized power, against anti-communism, anti-EU and anti-liberalism. The ideology is again very similar. On the other hand, the Kaczyński regime is much, much less corrupt than the Orbán regime. There is a strong anti-corruption rhetoric, and Kaczyński himself is not corrupt. So he is a believer. You know, when I said that Milosevic was not a believer, but an opportunist, the Serbian Milosevic and the Croatian Tudjman was not an opportunist, but a believer. It is very similar in the Polish-Hungarian relationship. Kaczyński is a believer and Orbán is an opportunist. So the religion is taken seriously in Poland, and the economy, on the other hand, is not occupied by the state. So it is still market driven, and therefore the Polish economic achievements and development is quite good. And here we have an overview between 2007 and 2017, democracy scores according to the nations in transit. And here this is Poland, a slight decline after 2015, and the decline is continuous. And a big decline in the case of Hungary by 2017. And all these things are continuing. Poland was declining faster after 2017. But among the post-communist countries, Estonia, Slovenia, Latvia, Czech Republic, Lithuania are doing pretty well. Most recently, Slovenia is getting more autocratic. And Bulgaria, Romania is still highly problematic. Maybe Bulgaria is now in the last place, but Romania is catching up. So the European Union did basically three things. They were trying to constrain the regime. They unwillingly supported the regime, and they also legitimized the regime. So we wrote an article with Daniel Hegedűs in which we observed that the European Union has an externally constraining power on a Hungarian hybrid regime. So maybe the constraint is the most important, but in the meantime, the EU is enabling, supporting and legitimizing the Orbán regime, giving them a lot of money that is misused by the regime, and also by behaving so, they indirectly say that there is nothing special in Hungary. And therefore the European Union, the European Commission particularly, should be blamed for the Hungarian situation. Of course, the first responsibility should go to the Hungarian citizens and Hungarian voters, who re-elected Viktor Orbán, even in a non-free elections. So the constraining function of the EU is that they can be effectively constraining the regime as long as they have some legal basis for intervening. There is a European Court of Human Rights, and that court is operating on case law, step by step, defending fundamental rights. And it has a solid basis in the treaties. So in that sense, the European Union is effectively constraining the regime, you know, defending the rights of the sexual minorities, the homeless people, other minorities, the Roma minorities, against discrimination, and can defend the human rights. But the European Union cannot defend democracy as a system, because they do not have a systemic approach to any member state. As I said, they turn to the member state and telling them to change their policies. But if they don't change, they cannot do anything. So in that sense, you know, preventing the decline of democracy, the European Union is ineffective. They are effective in maintaining the liberal component, but ineffective in maintaining the democracy. So therefore, contrary to the conviction of a lot of people, for instance, Hungary is not any liberal democracy, because the liberal component might be even stronger than the democratic component. It is more like a, in quotation, liberal autocracy, because the some individual rights are protected by the European Union, but the democratic regime is not protected. So therefore, it is an extremely unusual, never happened before, contradictory situations, defending case by case some rights of individuals and groups, but inability to defend the quality of democracy. So human rights and liberties of the Hungarian citizens are not guaranteed by some constitutional institutions, but the Hungarian citizens can turn to the European Court of Human Rights, and the European Court of Human Rights can delete the wrong application of the law. On the other hand, the European Union, European Commission lacked the political will to confront the Orbán regime over the dismantling of liberal democracy, except for some infringement procedures. Basically, those were helpless to prevent the further decline. The European Parliament was more active, accepting the Tavares report in 2013 and the Sargentini report in 2018. These were, you know, monitoring the Hungarian situations and giving a report and blaming the Hungarian government. That was accepted, but no further steps were taken because of the lack of the political will of the European Commission. And the European People's Party had a very dubious role. The Fidesz and Orbán was member of this party family. That is a center-right party family. Also, Angela Merkel was member of this. And that is the biggest one in the European Union. And Fidesz brought 12 votes to this group, to this family. And the European People's Party needed the Fidesz votes in the European Parliament. So they became corrupt, accepting Orbán's votes, which were in favor of them in Brussels, while disregarding the domestic policies of the Orbán regime. And finally, the EPP suspended the membership of Fidesz in 2020, just at the beginning of the pandemic. And in 2021, Fidesz was forced to leave the European People's Party. So Viktor Orbán was an important player in Europe 5 years ago, but now he is marginalized. He is trying to make friendships with Salvini, but even Salvini is moving to the center a little bit, or Marine Le Pen. I mean, he never came closer to these guys until recently, and also to the Italian neo-fascist or post-fascist party. So you can see here what the Hungarian citizens could do after 2013, when the Hungarian judicial system were corrupted, then there were more and more applications sent to the European Union. This is the number of the European Court of Human Rights application and pending cases from Hungary. So it was very low level, and suddenly it was jumping up. So it is seen that Hungarian citizens are using the European High Court as an appeal, as a possibility for appeal against the Orbán regime. In the meantime, the European Union is supporting the regime because of the cohesion funds. The EU has cohesion transfers to poorer regions, poorer countries, and all of these new member states are receiving funds every year, important amount of money in order to catch up their living standards to the average of the European Union. So this cohesion fund is used. These countries are developing, but Hungary is underachieving as compared to its possibilities because this money is not really used properly and not given equal chance for all entrepreneurs. The market economy is poisoned by political intervention. So therefore, with this bunch of money, the EU contributes to maintaining a non-democratic regime within the European Union, and even the European Union can legitimize it because, you know, there are fundamental values, the Lisbon Treaty, Article 2, but still Hungary and Poland are disrespecting the democratic values, and still the European Union, as long as, you know, until 2020, did not do anything serious to prevent this. So it was actually indirect legitimization of the regime. So therefore I argue that Hungary is considered as an externally constrained hybrid regime, externally constrained and in brackets externally sustained and legitimized hybrid regime within the European Union. And this character might cease to exist and the country can move forward to full authoritarianism if the European Union cancels its cohesion policy, because at the moment the Orbán regime is dependent on the leverage of the European Union. If they don't receive any money, then they might leave the European Union, because for Orbán, maintaining his personal rule is more important than the European money. Or alternatively, if the European Union decides to not to follow, not to take seriously its own liberal and democratic values, and they cease to exist as a liberal democratic value community. If they abandon its own constraining function, then it is there is no need to comply to this by the Orbán regime. But I think none of this will happen. I think more than two-thirds of Hungarians are in favor of the European Union very strongly. There are hundreds of thousands of Hungarians, if not a million, who are working abroad in Austria, in the UK, and now more in the Benelux and Germany and Scandinavian countries. So there is a linkage and leverage which is increasing, and the popularity of the Orbán regime is decreasing in Hungary. The Orbán regime lost the local elections in 2019. In Budapest, 75%, according to the latest poll, is supporting the opposition. the mayor of Budapest is coming from the opposition and the mayors of the bigger cities. So the regime support is based on the villages, small towns, countryside population, elderly population, those who are sort of isolated from the real news, because the media is sort of insulated. So people who don't speak English or who don't use social media, they are simply not knowing what is going on, because the lack of information goes together with relentless government propaganda. But now it seems to me that there can be a real change in a way that people, at the moment, the opposition is leading by 10% against the Orbán Fidesz. Of course, the election might be cheated or will be cheated, but 10%, 15% is a pretty big gap. If the opposition can keep this gap, then they can accidentally will win the election. If the opposition wins only by 2 or 3%, that will not be enough because of the gerrymandering. It is like, you know, the election of the US in 2016, when the popular vote was won by Hillary Clinton, but still Donald Trump vote the Electoral College vote due to the gerrymandering. So that's the situation. The opposition has to win, but not a little win. They need a big win in order to change the regime. And what can be the reasons of democratic backsliding? Is it just a problem for Hungary and Poland? Or is it also a problem maybe for Italy, for Austria, or Serbia, other countries? So how can we locate this democratic backsliding? So in the post-communist case, the immediate introduction of neoliberal economic policy, speedy privatization and austerity policies, that contributed to the end of the liberal era and the rise of populism and nationalism. And even if there was economic development, the fruits, the benefits of this economic development was not distributed fairly, evenly. There was an unfair distribution, this redistribution from the poor to the rich, rather than equalizing the tendencies. So growing social inequalities undermined the credibility of democracy, and people were waiting for a genuine left-wing party, but the left was collaborating with the liberals, and they were much more interested in emphasizing neoliberalism, managerialism, modernization, rather than social solidarity. So people became disappointed with the left. And I think the left is doing pretty poorly in a lot of other countries, in France, in the UK, in Italy. Maybe they are doing better in Spain and now Germany. But in Hungary, in the post-communist era, those leftist voters turned to the far right, because they were waiting for some respect. And this is what neoliberalism did not offer for him, because the neoliberal policy suggested that only those who are performing well deserve further support. And what about the losers? What about those who are handicapped, who cannot perform well, and they were not treated equally? And then these people turned, they could not turn to the far left, so they turned to the far right. And then came the political crisis in 2008, 2009. And in those countries, when there was a charismatic, strong man, those could exploit this situation. And leadership also matters, not just structural factors, but leadership. And Orbán is undeniably a charismatic leader for about one third of the population. They really trust him. They believe him. Like Fidesz is not like a political party anymore. It's like a political church. They are just believing in Orbán. Orbán can do whatever he wants because they will never be, you know, shaken or changing, turning to another policy. So that's a problem. It's like Perón in Argentina. People believe until the last moment. And the political formula is this of this rule is the applied ethno-nationalism, social conservatism, you know, mentalities. The attitude of the Hungarians are sort of claustrophobic. Hungarian language is isolated. Not really many people understand. So that helps also conservatism, nationalism, you know, fearing from foreigners, being suspicious to foreigners, anti-neoliberal rhetoric, and so on. And they easily accept the idea of a homogenization of culture and the discrimination against unwanted others, be them refugees, migrants, Roma, gays, lesbians, or Jews. Those are target groups, easy targets. So there is also an identity politics here. You don't have to argue. You just say that those are the enemies. No need for argument. And this is what Fidesz like. And easy enemies, you know, those minorities are easy to combat. And also there is some moral fervor that we are the people and nobody else can tell us what to do. And also there is a responsibility here for the conservative elite, because the conservative elite supported the nationalists and the radical right. 15 years ago, the conservatives found more important to support the radical right than to the centrist politicians and the centrist political forces. So there is a permanent political campaign, propaganda campaign against Brussels, the United Nations, Soros, the global elites, and somehow they try to sell the message that we are in opposition to the whole world. So everybody needed.
May I interrupt you a bit? That is, why does Orbán, for example, contest the United Nations? On what basis?
Well, that was just a relatively short period of time when the United Nations wanted to address gender issues, for instance. And they adopted some vocabulary that was not liked by Orbán, that, you know, there is only men and women. And, you know, there is a homophobia, transphobia. And when anything is appeared in the text of the United Nations, which addressed these groups of people, then the Orbán regime claimed that the United Nations wants to homogenize and they don't respect the Hungarians. But the United Nations is not a real enemy. It was just for a short period of time. The European Union and Soros and Brussels. And, you know, there are also some friends. The major friends used to be Erdogan and Putin. They are still friends. Kaczynski, of course. And the Serbian leader, Vucic. Janša from Slovenia. And yeah. And also Donald Trump. And
Israel.
And Israel, yes, Netanyahu. But now Orbán lost Netanyahu, lost Donald Trump, lost Salvini. So Angela Merkel is not maintaining him anymore. So Orban's position is getting weaker and weaker. I mean, Boris Johnson is not a supporter of Orban, so he is now supported by non-democrats, by Erdogan and Putin, but Putin is always keeping a distance from everybody. So it's Orban is very weak within the European Union right now. The European People's Party is against him, and now he is in the far right. And let me move. Yes, I am finishing it now. This will be the last two slides. One word about the religion. The religion is nationalized, as I said. It is understood as Christendom. Not Christianity in a true sense, you know, in a person-to-person understanding, but in a nationalist way. And also it includes a coded anti-Semitism, but it is not open, it is coded. And also an open Islamophobia. But that is also driven by political benefits. Islamophobia as regards to the poor people, but if some rich people want to buy Hungarian citizenship from Saudi Arabia or Qatar, they can buy it easily. At that point, it doesn't matter whether it is an Arab or non-Arab person. So, and also the Pope is considered as a liberal by the Orban regime, and therefore they don't want to trust the Pope. It's amazing how much the Hungarian Catholic Church still supporting Orban, and minorities in Transylvania, in Romania, which are dependent very much on Orban, they receive a lot of money. They again ready to support the nationalist church and the prime minister. So it is a very carefully created and crafted system. I think Orban is a very talented politician. He could keep his own power for 11 years, but he is making a huge damage. And even if he will be losing, it will mean that it will take a lot of years to repair the current damage which is done on Hungary. And this is a final slide on the democratic decline, that is until 2018. And that is not just the European Union, it is more global data. And it here Hungary looks a little bit better vis-a-vis Serbia, Turkey, Venezuela. United States went even down a little bit, but now I think they managed to stay in the liberal democracies. So that's about it. Thank you very much for your attention. I'd like to stop sharing my slides, and if you have any questions, please let me know. Oops, how to stop sharing?
Yes, already done.
Ah, okay. Thank you very much.
Okay, so thank you very much, András, for your lecture, for your talk, and now the floor is open, of course, to your comments and questions, of course. So please feel free to put them on the chat or take the mic directly. And so let's see what happens. But my question is this. So I have two questions, related questions. So the first one is what the European Union should do. Because of course you talked about the possible consequences of cutting cohesion funds by the EU and so on and so forth. But what the European Union should do to bring Hungary back to a full liberal democracy, first of all. And second is the debate is about the debate on the so-called differentiated integration. You know that in Europe there is this debate on the future of the European Union and on the fact of the differentiated integration as a way to further integration in the European Union. Of course, Hungary is a possible candidate to be left out, for possible integration and so on. So, how do you see this scenario, and what would be the impact on Hungary? And would Hungary accept this kind of scenario, differentiated integration? And I don't know whether this debate is going on in Hungary. So,
okay, yes, thank you very much. I mean, these are very important questions, and it is very hard to tell what to do. It seems to me impossible to kick out Hungary from the European Union. And that would be, I mean, legally, that would be very difficult. So we have to figure out something else, maybe a differential treatment. So maybe the European Union should say that we set up a deadline, 1 year, and if you don't do that, don't comply, don't return to the democratic path, then all other countries should move forward, except Hungary. So not kicking out, but everybody steps forward, but leaving Hungary or maybe some other countries there, as long as they are not changing their policies. So there should be some punishment. I agree. There should be a punishment, but I think it should be painful, but somehow it should be very, very cleverly targeted, you know, to punishing the leaders, but not the ordinary people. So, for instance, you know, closing the border would be a disaster, but there should
because
be,
of course, this is the classic problems of sanctions in broader terms. That is the so-called rally around the flag problem, no? If you want.
Yeah, and Angela Merkel said that, you know, you have to just wait and see. You have to be patient, and Orbán will be out sooner or later. Let's wait. But of course, the German car factory was in Hungary, the Mercedes-Benz and the Audi, etc. So, and BMW. So, I think there should be a targeted sanction to the political leadership. So, maybe redistributing this support to some non-government agencies, maybe. The government should not get anything, but some NGOs. I mean, there should be some reaction that these irresponsible criminal elements should feel the consequences. So there should be a targeted punishment, and it is very tricky. It is very difficult. I think the United States did not do anything under Trump, so they should do also much more. I mean, they know everything about the corruption issues about Orbán and his gang, but they are not revealing it. So I'm sure that they know everything about it, but somehow they are waiting. I think it's right that it is the job of the Hungarian people to get rid of these dictators. I mean, it's impossible to wait for the American troops to come and liberate Hungary. I mean, it's not even a good policy, because people should think, and they have to do something themselves and not waiting for liberation by others. So that is my answer. There should be sanctions, but sort of targeted, focused sanctions. And in the meantime, other member states should move forward. And then the Hungarian voters will realize that they are lagging behind. they are deprived from benefits, and then they should think again. Yes.
There is a question. So maybe Eduardo, I don't know if you wanted to take the mic and read your question or something like this, or do you want me to read it?
Well, I can also read it.
Okay. I hope you can hear me.
Thanks for the
lecture. Eduardo is
speaking. Thanks for the lecture. I'd like to know, in your vision, if there are currently some liberal democracies on the verge of becoming a hybrid regime, as you said. And I would appreciate if you could give one or two words about the Brazilian situation, maybe the role of the elections next year. Thank you.
Yes, you are speaking from Brazil, right?
No, I'm here at the class.
Ah, you are here in the class. Ah, okay. But you are Brazilian, right, or not?
Yes.
You're okay.
Thank you very much. So your question is relevant because, as I try to say, that it looks like an Orban problem, but illiberalism and autocratization and democratic backslide is much bigger issue than only Orban. Because Orban is a leader of a small country, but there is Bolsonaro, Donald Trump, Duterte in the Philippines, and you know, the reversed politics in China. So it is a real dangerous situation because Modi in India became more and more populist or nationalist. Some people say fascistic. So it is not just the familiar faces, the familiar autocrats like Putin and Erdogan, but indeed Latin America, the small countries between Mexico and Costa Rica, you know, Guatemala and these. And Brazil, of course. Brazil, Venezuela is obviously an autocratic regime. And Brazil is still a democracy, but it is increasingly an illiberal one. And Bolsonaro wants to copy Donald Trump and Kaczynski. It goes to the similar direction. I would call Brazil as a majoritarian illiberal democracy. But I am not an expert on Brazil, whether it is already a hybrid regime or not. We should check out whether the next elections will be democratic or not.
Okay. Did you reply to my second question about differentiated the integration?
Yes, I think that's a good suggestion. There should be, I mean, the original idea is that all countries belong to the European Union and they have the same rights and same duties. But if there is a, you know, conscious destruction of the democratic values, then it is a violation of the European community values and laws. So in that sense, I think a member state should be punished. The problem is that they have a unanimity vote. Everybody wants to vote. And Poland and Slovenia will not vote against Hungary because they are friends. So that's very important for Orban to have similar persons. Nevertheless, there should be some decisions which require only majority and not unanimity. And if they can broaden this majority decisions, then they should be creative and find some solutions to punish these political regimes, but also give the chance to come back after Orban. Because that would be very bad that finally Orban is replaced by a new democratic government, and finally the European Union will start punishing the democratic government when Orban is already away. Yes, this is my comment.